Music Box has finally managed to track down somebody that we've been wanting to talk to for ages. Well, somebody I've been wanting to talk to since I was about 13, I think. Brian Ferry, formerly lead singer with Roxy Music, who's just released his latest solo LP. Now, we didn't find him in Nassau, we didn't find him in New York, we found him in an English garden, which seems to be a rather appropriate, if slightly windblown, sort of setting. Brian, your new LP, Boys and Girls, is already legendary for having cost supposedly a fortune to make and having been a couple of years or something in the making. What's the truth behind all that? It's legend already.
you didn't expect to get that from me. it took a long time, about 18 months on and off in the studio. And I suppose it started off as a very kind of cheap album to make, actually. So, I started working at home on a very simple 8-track system and trying to opt for a cheap and cheerful approach, you know. And then by the time it got to a year and a half or so later, it had all reached kind of staggering proportion. And we were sort of working on 48-track on all of the songs. So there was an awful lot of music there on tape, and it took a very long time to mix it, to get it right, because it's kind of music built up out of very simple parts, really, but complex, because there's so many different musicians bouncing off each other and so on. So it took a long time to mix, and that's when it becomes really expensive.
Did you change your mind about the simple thing then, or did it just sort of run away?
No,
with
it
you?
just grew as I got more and more involved in it. I tend to sort of think about nothing else really when I'm working on an album like that. It becomes a sort of special project, you know. I become very obsessive about it and I sort of head down and get into it, you know. And we travelled from studio to studio. We went to a lot of different places to record it. We were in New York and then London and various studios, and in Nassau, where we went for a couple of trips, which we did on the last album on Avalon as well. We found that's sometimes a good sort of change of pace, change of environment, you know, because generally you're in the studio for like, could be 10 hours a day or something, and it's usually quite unhealthy. So.
Are you a very extreme sort of perfectionist? I mean, do you keep going over and over and over things to get them absolutely perfect?
I try and push an idea as far as I can. And if something sounds good, you know, I think, well, that's okay, but can we do it any better than that?
But isn't there a danger that you keep kind of, that one can keep like refining and refining and refining?
That is the danger.
Until you've got something that's too smooth.
Something you have to be very wary about, that you don't kind of polish it too much, because it's emotional music. And if you do work on it too much, you'll kind of get rid of some of the rough edge, which is very important. It's the way I work now, is to work over a long period in the studio, building up a song and building up a mood and an atmosphere, whatever.
What are you like at work? Do you work in a relaxed sort of way? I mean, it's quite hard to imagine you leaping up and down and getting really excited about this fantastic new guitar sound.
I have a very important colleague I work with, my engineer, who's there with me all the time, and engineer and producer, Rhett Davis, and he's worked with me for a few albums now. And so we have quite a close relationship, and he's, I suppose, steadier than I am. So I get the chance to kind of to do just that, to jump up and down and so on. It depends on what you're doing, you know. Some days you get really excited and dancing all over the place. And other days it's like really serious stuff, and it's all hands down on the desk and, you know, doing the work. Every day is different, that's what makes it interesting.
The LP is dedicated to your late father, and I know that you've said that you enjoyed a very happy family life. What was your childhood like?
Well, it was good.
Were you a very serious little boy?
I varied between alternated between being very serious and being very naughty, I think.
Were you a good scholar?
When I tried, I was, yeah.
One of those could try harder.
That's right, yeah. I went to a very nice school. It was a kind of a regular sort of grammar school, you know, boys and girls, mixed school. And did lots of sport and stuff. And when I, towards the end of my time there, I got sort of interested in art and so on. And I had a teacher there who encouraged me an awful lot. We used to go out and get drunk together. and he set me on the path.
You seem to have gone through quite drastic changes of lifestyle or image or whatever that go a lot deeper than, say, the costume changes that David Bowie's so famous for. I mean, to go from being a Newcastle school teacher to being an arty, glamorous rock figure to being a sophisticated sort of man of the world that everyone thinks that you are now. Have you consciously recreated yourself?
Well, I suppose I always wanted to follow my own way, you know, to not be anybody else but myself, be my own man, you know. And I suppose life is a sort of adventure, you know.
Well, yes, and everybody changes, but it's such a marked thing to go. I mean, I know nothing's ever quite that simple, but to go from being a school teacher in Newcastle to a figure who's like internationally seen as this incredibly, you know, sophisticated, elegant.
Well, that was just one job I did, you know, for about a year. After school, I went to university for 4 years, and there I kind of met a lot of people who were like myself, who were interested in art and you know, painting, all the rest of it. Some of them went on to be actors or filmmakers or different things. I eventually turned into a musician.
Did you used to have an accent, a Newcastle accent?
Sort of, but where I came from, it wasn't. It was in Durham, which is a bit softer than the Geordie thing that you're used to hearing on what's it, a Vida's End thingamajig. But it's a very nice accent. It's very hard to do. But you can't do it.
I bet you can.
Why, I?
Through rock, I mean, keeping on that theme just for a second, I mean, you seem to have achieved something that usually takes generations, which is sort of becoming an aristocrat, or what looks like an aristocrat to other people. I mean, you've got a home in the country. Are you Lord Ferry of the Manor at home?
Hardly. I'm not really there that much. I mean, I tend to live out of a suitcase more than anywhere else, you know. Because I do sort of, I work a lot, you know, I like my work, and people always kind of write about the thing that's easiest, you know, and they think, oh, well, that's a bit unusual, because he goes there
or does that.
Striding
through his muddy acres.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's all, that always makes copy for people. That's only a kind of small part of my life. I mean, I do like nature, and I like being in the countryside, because it's a way of keeping sane for me, of getting away from places like New York, whatever, where I tend to work. You know, city, the hard urban environment, whatever. And to escape from that and to have my own world, a peaceful sort of place as well. And that's why I think I've always managed to keep on having a sort of enthusiasm about what I do. So I never got sick of it. So I always managed to do a piece of work and retire from it, and then store up some enthusiasm, energy to do something else, then do that, and so on. And to try and balance the two was really important for me.
You must look back at Roxy Music. Is that something that you do normally, I mean, when people aren't actually asking you about it?
Only when I'm asked about it do
really?
I think about it, really.
Really?
Because it's the past, you know? And
well, but people do think about the past.
I guess I never have time to these days. But it's a very, you know, it's a pleasant past, and as good as most people.
It must be tremendously satisfying, I mean, to look back on 10 years of Roxy Music and know that, I mean, Roxy Music as a group never really kind of, well, never seemed to make any really dreadful mistakes, or did they?
No, we...
I mean, with most bands, it's like one dodgy album or one turning that they took that maybe wasn't such a good idea. But
yeah, no, that's right. I think that there's something, a certain quality or whatever about each album. I didn't want to do any duff albums, so I did try not to.
I don't think anybody wants
but,
to.
I guess we should have toured a bit more, maybe. But there again, it wasn't the side of that that appealed to me so much. I really like being in the studio, doing the new thing all the time, rather than just, you know, performing old stuff, whatever.
Do you cringe when you see old pictures of yourself? I mean, in some of the costumes and the makeup and things like that.
No, I kind of beam with admiration at this wonderful young figure. No, it's always funny if you look at old photographs of yourself. I would laugh and think of something that might have happened at that period or whatever.
What was Roxy's finest hour, do you think?
Hard to say. I mean, some people would say the first album. That's kind of, can be very irritating when they say that. But for me, I like the second one very much, For Your Pleasure. I just liked a lot of the songs on that one, and it just seemed to have a very good flavour, a good mood about it. And it was done in a rush, like a lot of things I did were done in that way, and sometimes good things come out of it, that pressure, you know. But Avalon was also, which was the last one, had something about it too. So I didn't want the group to get into that period of decline, you know, that you can sometimes get into if the chemistry stays together too long. And
but was it still a group, I mean, by the end?
No, it was a group, I thought, for about 2 years. and afterwards it became less and less so. For me, it was important to always bring in new people to keep excited about it. So there was always a kind of shifting of personnel, which made it interesting. But it became more of a kind of idea for a group rather than the same bunch of people together all the time.
What's your favourite Roxy Music single?
Well,
on the spot.
well, I suppose Virginia Plain, probably the first one. Because it had that kind of energy thing, which I like to hear on a single. Also, it was never really on an album. In those days, the first two singles we did, they weren't on albums. We just put them out as a separate thing, which was quite interesting, I thought.
Today's young breed of pop stars are grilled relentlessly all about their politics and stuff like that. Something, a fate that you seem to have avoided, by and large, until now. So
I don't really take a political stance, you know, and I think it is possible to do what I do without feeling that I'm obliged to kind of be a political sort of figure or something. I veer from extreme left to extreme right. Depends on what time of the day you catch me.
What about like non-party issues? I mean, things like CND and blood
sports. I'm kind of interested in the whole kind of ecology thing, you know, but conservation of what we have, because, you know, and if you travel around the world, it makes you, I suppose, more aware of the fact that the world is being screwed up all the time, more and more, you know, by too much industry and people just not caring enough. Greed is the main thing. I don't really feel very happy about all that kind of stuff.
Do you think that an artist, I don't mean like a pop singer, but I mean an artist, if you take that as a sort of breed, can actually sort of worry about the whole of humanity? Or do you just have to sort of concentrate
well,
on...
Well, I worry about it every day. But... I think they're troubled times that we live in, you know, and people say to me sometimes about the music you make is a bit kind of sad or something, whatever. It's a bit, has a melancholy flavour or whatever. And I think, well, how can it be anything else, you know?
Come to that.
Living in the times that we live in, you know.
Come to that. I mean, are you an artist?
Well, that's the kind of attitude that I have, yes. To my work, I don't feel the process really changes very much for me from when I used to be painting pictures or whatever. It's just different medium, and it's more satisfying for me because it's working with other people. It's a very much a team project all the time, working with other talented people and trying to shape their energies and their talents as well, you know, as well as my own. Yeah, it's a word I don't kind of dislike.
No. You're 40 now, aren't you? You haven't had your birthday yet.
Close, getting
close,
there.
Close. What do you think you'll be doing when you're 50? What will you be when you're 50? 60?
70? I don't know.
You must.
I have no idea.
I would hope you'd made enough to retire by the time you're 70.
I would have hoped so. And, people like Duke Ellington carried on making music, you know, and good music, you know, till
it's
much
more of
later.
A vexed question with pop singers, though, isn't it? Because it's always been a kind of like a youth
of
medium.
Course, yeah. But when I always think that when I started being a music fan at the age of about 11 or something, the first records I bought were made, it was music made by people who are older than I am now. So I think there's some future, there's some hope.
What
sort
do
of
you
jazz people and so on, you know, and blues singers, whatever.
Will you do covers LPs again? These Foolish Things type LPs where you interpret other people's songs?
Yeah, well, I like that album. At the time, it was done as a one-off, but in the years after that, I did a few more every now and then. And whenever a song comes up that I think of, that, yeah, I think I will. I think I might do something of that nature at some point.
You're still using very glamorous images of women in the artwork for the record and the video and so on. And you must have thought, obviously, that you're going to be attacked for being sexist and that the use of these kind of images is sexist and it might be offensive to women. Did you think about that and decide that it wasn't? Or does it not bother you what people say about that kind of thing?
No, because I think about it and I think it isn't. You know, I know it isn't. So it's a glorification of the female. As a rule, I mean, it started off as a kind of an exercise in advertising the first album cover we did, right? And all the others just carried on from there, just turned by accident, really, into a sort of series, because it worked. You know, that
but it could motor just as well be glamorous so images of you, though, couldn't it?
No, because I would prefer to be invisible. And I always like to deflect as much of that kind of thing as possible, the publicity thing, onto what I think looks better. And I would rather look at a picture of a beautiful woman than a picture of myself. So it's a kind of selfish thing as well.
What's the most unexpected glimpse of you that one might ever catch? I mean, away from your sort of public image.
I think having a good laugh. Sometimes you see interviews or something and you feel that, well, what isn't coming through there, as an impartial observer, is the sort of sense of humour thing, which to me is really important, especially when I'm working. You know, and you have days when you're really down, and other days when you're just—it's really funny. And I always find that the people I work with best are the people who I can share a kind of, you know, a sort of humour thing with. And
because you've often been seen as a sort of, you know, a lonely, rather melancholy sort of...
Miserable bugger.
No, a very romantic figure, but, you know, clothed in black, standing lonely on a hillside or something. I mean,
well, there's room for that as well. I mean, I think I don't like the idea of being stereotyped as anything, know, so...
But no, what I wanted to ask was that, I mean, now that you're entirely your own boss, you're married, you've got two children, are you a happy man?
Really hard to say. I mean, as happy as anybody can be, I suppose. Yeah. It's nothing I ever really analyse much and think, God, am I happy? You know, but I go from day to day and make out.